The Legend of the Great Pyramid, Part 3. For decades, if not centuries, students have listened to the conjectural thinking of their teachers. They have then spread the conjecture in a meaningful way as if it were fact in the first place. But the fact of the matter is, regarding the historical past, that the exotic assumptions and personal speculation has bewildered the modern world. We today have literally woken to this madness, the time of the Egyptians in contrast to what we believe. Is a history known by no one on this earth today? Yet, we are told it is known. The pattern of bewilderment has kept us in the dark. For a time, however, these stories were exchanged between intellectual circles. It wasn't a case of what you may have experienced, and rather, who could tell the best story about that experience. This cultural pattern has proven to have been a toxic splurting of words that spread like a disease across our planet. Theoretical thinking is not a lie either. You must speculate the midst of time to even begin to understand the past. Only by speculating can we arrive at the truth, but not to be confused with the presentation of a lie as a truth. That is different. The era of the pyramid builders and the fourth dynasty is a time present to us and what is known as a fact. When in actual fact, close to nothing is known about these people, and this history has been the victim of groundless assumptions that are fed to us as fact. Think about this. Egyptology suggests to us that the name Khufu had become to the dynastic Egyptians of the Middle and New Kingdoms what Jesus Christ is to us in the West today. By the time of the Middle Kingdom, the Old Kingdom was already ancient, forgotten about, and re-emergence was occurring. The name Khufu was used as protection, and this led to Khufu's seal being etched onto monuments and temples as a sign of protection. They basically are telling us that Khufu was a god who protected them, and maybe this is where the confusion regarding the Great Pyramid is spawning from. Maybe Khufu wasn't a king of the fourth dynasty. Instead, perhaps he lived many, many years before this period, and that he was actually a god called Khunum. After a period of separation, translations lapsed of the Middle Ages, and New Ages inspired the god Khunum as Khufu. Just a thought, and remember this, there are people alive today called Jesus. We don't automatically assume, however, that they are Jesus Christ. Good old Herodotus is responsible for this thinking. He assumed Khufu was a king, and such was his standing that he was believed. This, however, was thousands of years after Khufu was said to have been king. It is simply assumed and presented as fact. There are no historical records of these fourth dynasty kings, only the cartouches that represent a translation of their name. The inventory stela that has been classified as a fake by Egyptologists, because it says the Great Pyramid already stood at the time of Khufu's reign, but it does tell us that Khufu built the satellite pyramids of the Great Pyramid for his daughters. These smaller pyramids are unlevel, inaccurate, and stepped, similar to the nearby famous step pyramids of Saqqara and completely unlike the Great Pyramid. These satellite pyramids are an effort to replicate the wonder that was well in existence when these were erected. The Great Pyramid is responsible for revolutionary development in construction techniques that have never been replicated. It is the oldest pyramid, the most accurately aligned both to the stars and to the Earth's landmass. It has an apparent function, like a working machine, that has never been realized, and the scale of the monument sees it as the largest stone structure of ancient Egypt. Why don't we know what it is? In the king's chamber, there are 9 granite beams on the ceiling. This is the largest suspended granite space in the entire world, stretching 18 feet and thought to weigh over 40 tons. How did they get these beams in here without the use of crane technology? Engineers tell us this couldn't be done, yet here it is. The 9-ton red granite sarcophagus in this chamber is one of the most mind-boggling features of the Great Pyramid. Some have suggested that the Israelites took the Ark of the Covenant from this location and took it to Jerusalem, the Ark of the Covenant being a power source of the Great Pyramid's function in this theory. No artifacts, hieroglyphic inscriptions, or anything of any kind whatsoever to give us a clue as to what the pyramid was has ever been found, ever. This room, whatever it is, was sealed to an astonishing megalithic degree that we would be critically stupid to believe it was simply a tomb. The Giza Plateau is a huge limestone plate known as the Macadam Formation and was thought to have formed 56 million years ago. Macadam means cut off or broken off, refers to how the low range of hills is divided into three sections. In the past, the low mountain range was an important ancient Egyptian quarry site for limestone, used in the construction of temples and pyramids. However, the denser granite was shipped to the location from Aswan. More than 7 million limestone blocks with an average weight of 2.5 tons are installed in the three Giza Great Pyramids. Over the blocks, there are the brilliant white limestone slabs the pyramids were originally covered with. This white trim was used in medieval times as a quarry and used to build houses in Cairo. Only at the top of the middle pyramid, there are remnants of this panel. The Nile River seems to have been the key to transporting the blocks, but this hasn't been replicated despite efforts in 2018 by Channel 4 to prove this method. After the Great Pyramid and indeed the Giza Pyramids were constructed, they were never replicated. This is in spite of the fact that they are the oldest pyramids in Egypt. The construction methods regressed and did not improve, and even the Middle Kingdom pharaohs are telling us that they weren't connected to the Old Kingdom. All we are saying is that we begin to adapt our understanding because our timeline of the past doesn't make sense. It's all over the place, and the parroting of a thought by a person you trust shouldn't be repeated without known facts. It's fun to speculate, but not to present that speculation as if it were actual fact. This practice has left us blinded today. Also, guys, unrelated to Egypt, but we wanted to mention this about the new moon that has been orbiting the Earth for 3 years. The Minor Planet Center has just announced that the Earth has been orbited by a second moon for the past 3 years or so. But while excitement about the discovery is growing, it is important to keep in mind that this moon isn't as impressive as our main satellite. It is extremely faint. It is estimated to be only between 1 and 6 meters across, and won't be with us for much longer. The body was first spotted by US astronomers in Tucson, Arizona on February 15th. Subsequent observation enabled its orbit to be calculated, and at 10:53 p.m. Universal Time on February 25th, the Minor Planet Center announced the discovery of a new Earth moon, designating it as 2020 CD3 and confirming that it is temporarily bound to the Earth. Isn't that exciting? We will link that below and just wanted to mention it briefly, but what do you guys think about everything else presented here today? Comments below, and as always, thank you for watching.